Con for inviting us here. Fabulous arrangements and fabulous hospitality. Now, this is a simple talk. It's actually a half an hour talk, but if I can just give you a simple flavor of the talk, it'll really help you all. Every time you sit in your cabin, you get a patient coming to you with an x-ray packet, you'll whip out the x-ray with confidence, you'll look at it, and you won't even look at the report. But when he comes to you with the MRI packet, your hands are sheepishly looking for the report. You want to read the report first before you look at the films. So hopefully with this talk, we'll turn that and make sure that you can pick up the films and see what you can see. Now, why do we do the MR? We know this, anatomical delineation, soft tissues, non-invasive, and often the MR centers are taking in a slice of CT as well, because the CT will give you bone windows and thereby you're enhancing your reporting. Now, we've memorized a lot of stuff when we were doing our MBBS days. Now, whatever you need to know about the physics of MRI is all here in this one slide. So, the protocols of MRI, a lot of stuff has changed over a period of time. In the good old days, we would have T1, T2, T2 fat suppression, etc. Now, all you need to know is that there's something called T1 image, T2 images. There's a position in which the patient goes in for a shoulder MRI. It could be neutral or in abduction. There's a coil, which is a surface coil or a shoulder coil. You have three planes, axial, coronals, and sagittals we need to look at, and the sequences. So T1 shows you anatomy, T2 shows you pathology, PD is for proton density, and STIR is for spin tau inversion recovery. These are the four cycles we look at. Now, why these have come forth? Because the old T2 used to be very long. They want to cut short the MR imaging time, the time in which the patient is in the gantry. So the PD and the STIRs are much shorter. In 15, 20 minutes, you can get the whole scan done. So remember one thing, T1 is anatomy, T2 is pathology. And MR arthrograms will be done sometimes in case of tumor tissue or instability cases. So T1, T2, PD, proton density, and STIR. Now, a quick look at the anatomy. You need to know where your rotator cuff is. You need to know where your superior, middle, and inferior glenohumeral ligaments are. The MR reporting is all to do with anatomical correlation. So know where your coracoid is. So the moment you go to the base of the coracoid, the superior glenohumeral ligament is just about starting. If you look at the frontals or the coronals, spare a thought for your CHL, the coracohumeral ligament, which you have to look at in case of frozen shoulder cases. And here, on the, again on the frontal coronals, you need to look at the labrum at the top end and the bottom end. So we'll look at a few cases and we'll see how one should be reading this now. When you look at the MR shoulder, you need to have these films up on the board. So if you see the radiologists, they have huge screens. And the idea is they put up six films and they're going back and forth. Even the radiologist is not reporting on one film. They are corroborating. They're looking if this pathology is there on screen one. Are you seeing it in two and in three? And then they're picking out information from all three, adding it together. So the first film you have to put on, the sequence is you need the coronal films first, then you need the axials, and then you need the sag or the sagittals. And because the shoulder is in an oblique plane, they've added the word oblique, so don't get confused. So you have coronal obliques, you have the axials, and then you have the sagittal obliques. Now, first thing when you put up, look at this. This is another fact you have to remember. In T1 images, the marrow is always bright. Remember this as a gospel truth. And in all the images, the tendon is always dark. So T1, PD, STIR. On T1, marrow is always bright, tendons always dark across the board. So when you put this up, you need to have a system in place, just like how we were reading x-ray chest when we were in our MBBS days. Similarly for the MR, there's a system. And each radiologist will have his own system of reporting. The way I find it most easiest is go from top to bottom and go from out to in. That way you've seen everything and you're not missing pathology. There are some who will go by the structure, so they'll report bones, soft tissues, ligaments, and labrum. Some of them will do this, and some of them will look at pathology first and start reporting. So if you look at this from top to bottom, what I'm looking for is the acromion. I'm looking at the ACJ. I'm looking at the fat below the acromion. I'm looking for fluid here. I'm looking at the cuff. I'm looking at the head. I'm looking at the glenoid. I'm looking at the labrum here. I'm looking at the biceps emerging if I can. As you come down, I'm looking for the inferior labrum. I'm looking at the axillary recess. And then as you move down here, you're looking at the axillary vessels. So you have a system in place. As I go from out to in, I'm looking at the skin. I'm looking at the deltoid. I'm looking at the subdeltoid bursa. I'm looking at the cuff insertion. And then again, you're looking at the head and you look at the glenoid. So up to down, out to in. That way you don't miss pathologies. Now, Look at this. We've got three pictures back to back. So in T1, marrow is bright. In proton density, it's somewhere in between, and this is the stir image. So if you put three images, even the MR guys are looking at the color shades and they're picking up. They are not looking at the values. In the good old days, you'd think the T1 images have lesser values and the T2 would have higher images. They are not bothered now because with these mix and match sequences, the numbers can be misleading. So in T1, marrow is bright. In proton density, this is the best film to show you the cartilage tissue. Now look at the stir here. These are all at the same section. You see the cartilage is very well defined here. You don't see the cartilage well. In anatomy here, you'll see the marrow and you'll see the bony structure, but the cartilage again is thinned out. So the proton density images are very sensitive for cartilage. So if I'm looking at labrum, if I'm looking at the cartilage, I'm looking for the PD images. Now tendinosis, you see this here. So when you go down, you see the rotator cuff there. The tendons are black and all, as I said, but in tendinosis, in tendinopathy, in tendinitis, they'll start turning a bit gray. So if you see this homogeneous disturbance, if you see little fluid around it, in all likelihood, this is tendinosis. So they're all interchangeable. If you ask them which one is what, even they would not know, but they would tell you that there is some tendon disruption. Now let's look at the axials. So if you look at the axials here again, front to back, out to in. So if you go from front to back, so that's the anterior deltoid. You look at the biceps in the groove. This is the whole subscapularis coming and attaching. As you go down below the coracoid, you'll see the MGHL. This is the head, anterior labrum, posterior labrum, glenoid, and spare a thought for the suprascapular nerves and look for spinoglenoid cysts. As you come back, this is the infra, this is the capsule at the back, and this is your posterior deltoid. So up to down, out to in. That way you don't miss pathologies. An instability patient. So if you look at this, you've got the head here. There is some detachment here and you can see that. These are your stir sequences. But when you do that in your arthrograms, you'll see that it's all descended. Now look at this patient. So you've got subscap and biceps there. So if you see the axials, you'll find, I'm just going to take one more minute. So if you look at the axials, the subscap here is detached. There's fluid everywhere. The labrum looks reasonable. The biceps tendon is missing in the bicipital groove. And here you can see the infraspinatus. Now, the sagittal obliques. These again are important. So here, again, top to bottom, out to in, whichever way you want. So you're looking at the shape of the acromion. That's nice and flat here. That's a bit curved and this is hooked. So type 1, type 2, type 3, Bigliani. This has been questioned again, but for our purposes, this is sufficient. And if you look at the sagittals here, what you're looking for is the rotator cuff here. So how do you identify what is what? So the darkest portions, the tendon is dark in all the films. So this is your supra, this is your infra coming back, that is the biceps, and this is your subscap. So this becomes your rotator interval. That's the coracoid, this is the coracobrachialis running down. Now you see these are hooked, this is flat. So the obliques will tell you, sagittal obliques will tell you the shape of the acromion, the subacromial space, what's happening to the tendons, and most important, this interval here in the front in case it's a diabetic frozen shoulder. Now, shape of the acromion. If you look at the frontals again, look at this, nice and flat, and look at this, this is downsloping. So this is a morphological variant. This patient is just disadvantaged from birth. This will skip ahead. So look at this, the sagittal image through the AC joint. There is some amount of distension, there is some amount of cartilage fuzziness, there's fluid around it, there's some fluid below the AC joint. That's the coracoid here, this is the coracobrachialis in the short head, and that's the head. So here you can make out that there is some degree of ACJ arthropathy. Let's look at the ossa chromiale. Now this is something which you can get confused. If you look at this from top, the ossa acromiale will almost look like an AC joint itself. So this is, you don't see this very often. 15% of the patients will have it, but the top view will show a pseudo-cartilage formation in between here, and that's your natal. And on the AP coronals, you'll miss it actually. So if you're suspecting an ossa acromiale, you need to look at the top views. AC joint arthritis and spurring. So that's the AC joint, fuzzy, enlarged. That is a small spur below, lot of fluid below the acromion, and that's the tendon which is getting pinched. So this impingement is the most common diagnosis which you'll see on an OPD basis. Now, I think I'll stop here, we are overrunning on time. So this is a large talk, I normally do a breakfast session and then we look at all MR scans. So you can then look at the cuff, you can then look at instability, you look at infections, you look at tumors, and we can go on and on. But I think in principle, if you follow this format, you'll look at a lot of things, write down, 70% of your reporting will be matching what the radiologist will report. And as you keep doing this again and again, you keep getting better with your reporting and certainly more confident. So thank you, I'll stop here.